Hello, I'm Helen Ferre. On today's program, should an undocumented man receive a license to practice law? And how will South Florida's small business fare in 2014? But first, recreational marijuana has lit up Colorado. Will medical marijuana do the same for Florida? Ben Pallera, campaign manager and treasurer for the People United for Medical Marijuana, joins us today. Ben, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
I do want to say that we tried to get a different perspective to join us at the table today, but because of scheduling conflicts, that was not possible. There's a concern that some people have, not on the merits, well, and some people do have concerns about the merits of marijuana to treat a number of illnesses, but it is also a substance that can easily be abused. Why do you think, given Florida's pill mill situation, which has been scandalous, medical marijuana is going to be handled better?
Because I think that we put a lot of time and effort and research into drafting an amendment that creates a really tightly controlled and regulated system that does not lead to the kind of de facto legalization of marijuana that you see in California, which was the first state to pass medical marijuana.
And you know, that's a big concern, that this is a precursor to just taking us then to recreational marijuana.
Right. Well, and honestly, that has absolutely nothing to do with what we're trying to accomplish here. There are tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of Floridians who are suffering every day from debilitating diseases and medical conditions, and if their lives can be made better with the use of medical marijuana, and that's what their physician recommends to them, then they should be able to pursue that course of treatment without having to live like a criminal.
What do you consider, under your campaign, what do you consider appropriate treatment and or use for medical marijuana? What type of illnesses are we looking at? Originally, it started as a way to treat those HIV patients who had severe pain and as a way to stimulate the appetite, because with HIV, lots of times the medicines also suppress appetite. But now it's being used in a number of states, in Oregon and in California. It's used for minor arthritis, it's used for premenstrual pains, all kinds of different things, which is not maybe what it was intended for.
Sure. Well, our amendment limits the use of medical marijuana to people who are diagnosed with debilitating medical conditions and diseases, as determined by a licensed Florida physician.
Such as
HIV/AIDS, cancer, Dravet syndrome, fibromyalgia. I'm not a physician, and our amendment leaves it up to physicians and their patients to determine whether medical marijuana is appropriate. But it does say that it should be for a debilitating medical condition.
Are you surprised that there are people who are opposed?
Yeah, I'm always surprised that there are people opposed, but there are really not that many. I mean, it's much more difficult to find somebody who is opposed to this than somebody who's supportive. The vast majority of Floridians, you know, somewhere between 70% and 80% of Floridians support this.
So when we look at this, there's and you say that there's no danger of, or little danger perhaps, but no danger of this being interpreted or being misused with pill mills. What in the legislature leads you to believe that it would be a safe substance for physicians not to abuse?
Well, I mean, first of all, any system's going to have some abuse in it, right? And there's not a whole lot that you can do to prevent any abuse whatsoever, but we've created a very tightly controlled and regulated system. And at the end of the day, marijuana has never killed anybody. OxyContin kills people every single day. If I have a headache, I take Advil. NSAIDs kill 12,000 people a year in the United States. Marijuana has never been attributed directly to a single death ever in the history of its existence.
But it is an addictive substance. I mean, there's a controversy to marijuana, plus the enhanced THC variety that you see today. It's not your mom and dad's marijuana of 40 years ago. It's a different substance. Do you see, if this were to pass, who is going to be growing the marijuana? Is there going to be, there's so many different varieties, mm-hmm. and maybe there aren't, but I thought there were. How do you know which one's what? How controlled is this going to be?
The state is going to be authorized and directed to set up a system for safety, quality testing. And they're going to
have farms?
Yeah, and they're going to register and regulate medical marijuana treatment facilities in the state of Florida, which will include the folks that grow it, the folks that process it, the folks that deliver it, and ultimately the folks that sell it at retail.
It's a big business, isn't it?
I think it has the potential to be.
It will be a big business. When do you see a good model throughout the United States? Do you see a good model in the United States
for medical
that you
marijuana?
Could say for medical marijuana?
Yeah, I mean, I think Colorado has been a really good model for medical marijuana. And Massachusetts, although it just passed in 2012, we took a lot of the Massachusetts law in drafting ours. And Massachusetts is pretty widely recognized as having a very good controlled, restricted model that also allows a good amount of freedom for doctors and patients to decide in the course of treatment.
What kind of scientific evidence do you think exists to be able to support the use or the legalization of medical marijuana? What kind of studies are we looking at?
You know, there are studies that come out every day on this stuff, and there are new wrinkles in the marijuana picture on a regular basis. There was a study out of Israel not that long ago that showed that a strain of cannabis actually killed cancer cells in their study. They're doing clinical trials right now for variations of CDB to treat seizure disorders like epilepsy. You know, there are new pieces of research coming out on this every day, but it's difficult to do the research because it's illegal at the federal level, and so it's very difficult to get the authorizations to even perform research or grow marijuana for research.
Given that this is such a big conversation on a national level, organizations such as the American Medical Association and so on, do they have a pronouncement regarding the use of medical marijuana?
I'm sure they do. I'm not aware of it.
If they had one in favor of it, I'm sure you would be. I'm sure you would be aware of it. This, you think, is going to, you have enough signatures to put it on the ballot?
We will as of Monday or Tuesday next week.
Oh, that's really fast.
Yeah, we're on a very tight deadline right now.
And then the language, when you get signatures for the ballot, do you have the language that's going to be on the ballot presented to potential voters?
Yeah, our petition is 2 pages back and front, and that's the bill. There's a 75-word summary, which is what will appear on the ballot, but then the 2 pages is actually what will go in the Florida Constitution.
And that election is going to be in November.
Yes.
It's going to be I think probably a bigger turnout than most people would normally expect in a midterm election, because we also have a gubernatorial election being held at the same time.
Right, and that so much money is going to be spent on that gubernatorial election that. There's going to be a lot of people voting.
One last question. You consider the big potential that medical marijuana could have from a business perspective, and I can definitely see that being an important business consideration. Has any business interest, to your knowledge, expressed any interest in getting involved in this?
Yeah, I get emails every day from people from Colorado and California that have expressed interest in coming to the state, but we don't know what medical marijuana will look like in Florida if it does pass. And this is, while there's an obvious economic interest in this, this is not why we're doing this. We're doing this because there's, you know, tens if not hundreds of thousands of really sick people out there who want this and who need this and whose doctors have said this could help you. And so if nobody makes a dollar on this, you know, I'd be fine with that, because we're doing this for the sick people.
And so it's going to be treated differently than the pharmaceutical industry, or the same way?
In terms of taxation?
In terms of taxation and in terms of regulation?
It'll be somewhat of a unique situation. I mean, it's going to be much more difficult to get a certification and an identification card to obtain medical marijuana than it would be to get and fill a prescription for you know, very dangerous narcotics like OxyContin.
Ben Pollard, thanks so much for having us today.
Thank you
for joining us today. Not having us, for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks. Up next, should you be able to practice law if you are undocumented? Stay with us. A Tampa area man who is undocumented passed the Florida bar and would like to receive his law license, similar in some ways to a case in California. But can he, or should he, practice? Ediberto Roman, professor of law at Florida International University, is here to discuss this and more. Good to see you, Professor. How are you?
Good to see you.
Let me ask you something. There is a similar case that passed in California, but it's similar only insofar as this is a, quote, dreamer who was applying for the same type of license, but California has a different set of rules and regs than we do in Florida. I said this man is undocumented, but that may not even be the case. We're talking about Jose Godinez Sampeiro from the Tampa Bay area, but he's applied for deferred action and has now a Social Security number?
That's right. He's received it. And as you know, the Deferred Action Program is a program started by President Obama to essentially use the discretion that the executive branch has to basically allow individuals that have essentially done nothing wrong other than be children when their parents brought them here and like Jose's case, overstayed their visa. And in many of these instances, these individuals did not even know their status when they went to
college. He was, I believe, 9 years old.
9 years old. Exactly. And in this case, he applied to Florida State University, was admitted, graduated, applied for the bar, went through the character and fitness application, and the application, not unlike a document like this, it's well over 100 pages, that goes through his entire history and essentially found the bar as well as the law school that is in effect an agent of the state as well as the bar found nothing wrong with his character and fitness, but unfortunately because of the requirement in the state to essentially identify your residency, that was a holdup that the bar asked the Supreme Court to address.
Why would that be an unfortunate circumstance? You have to pass the bar and be resident of every state that you take a bar for. Or maybe not. Maybe you could pass the bar for California and actually reside in the state of Florida. But doesn't it make sense that residency or legal documentation be presented if you're going to be an officer of the court as an attorney?
Well, I guess the question really is that the notion of character and fitness. If you have the appropriate character to be an officer of the court. And we're really looking for individuals who are not individuals that will violate the law readily. And there's nothing to indicate in Jose's case or in Sergio Garcia's case, who I worked with and pushed the governor in that scenario, Jerry Brown, with a petition.
The case in California.
Exactly. The petition signed by over 100 experts from around the country, all supporting his petition. In that case, there was a political process as well as a courtroom process.
Now, that situation was different because in California, you do, in fact, have DREAM Act. Sergio did not have deferred action
exactly.
status because he had aged out of that process already.
Right.
So on multiple levels, it's different. In this case of Jose Godinez, his is more simple because now he does have, through deferred action, he doesn't have legal status, but he does have permission to be able
right.
to work.
Yeah.
What deferred action essentially says is you are not deportable for a 2-year period.
Exactly. And essentially the USCIS, the United States Citizenship and Immigration Service, has recognized that they are here in effect lawfully through the deferred action for that 2-year period, but doesn't have official legal status. In some respects, Jose's case is stronger in that his particular circumstances make it stronger in that he has deferred action. But unfortunately, the political environment in the respective states are very different. Well, as you pointed out, California has a DREAM Act, and it's generally been more supportive of immigrants, notwithstanding the fact that the dynamics in terms of population are very similar, the large Hispanic community in this state. This state has been unfortunate in that it's been very hostile on a host of fronts, including with respect to lawsuits related to in-state tuition and a host of other issues. And it's highly unlikely that Governor Scott, given his record, would be supportive of anything associated with an undocumented person.
Part of the concern that people have regarding the issue of DREAM Act and or in-state tuition permission to be able to do that for those who aren't here legally is that they fear that it might Florida might become a greater magnet
yeah.
for those who are undocumented for coming.
That's classic hyperbole that's usually stated by pundits and those that want to raise fear. And it's not based on facts. Actually, in a recent book I published, it's called Those Damn Immigrants, addresses all of these sorts of attacks of the economic downturn, the cultural population overthrow. None of those arguments that are bantered about on Fox News and CNN all too often are based in anything resembling reality.
You don't see a clash of civilizations, but there is a clash against what is law on the books.
particularly with respect to undocumented adults that came over. But we're talking a very different story here. We're talking a child, and in many of these cases with dreamers, infants. Talk about innocence. These individuals are epitomize that, and they are the face of, frankly, undocumented immigration in many respects, because when we have these debates, we tend not to talk about the reason why migration occurs. It's because of domestic employment interests, business sectors, in agriculture, construction, and the service industries that seek out these individuals and create this demand. So we're not, and in the case of these dreamers, particularly a law grad dreamers, did nothing wrong, came here as a child, and not only abided by all the rules, met the highest threshold in terms of being admitted to the bar, being admitted to law schools because they have to address the character issues, and then having the bar examiners go through his materials and find he was well suited to practice. It's only this impediment because of the lack of federal legislation on the issue.
Dreamers are rarely depicted as victims. But you could say they really are, because the law is broken by no fault of their own. Why are they not presented more like victims? Because that makes them the parents, the criminals?
I think in some respects that's the narrative, but the narrative heretofore for well over a century has been to demonize and scapegoat these voiceless individuals. Only more recently, through the activism of these young people, have we seen them and begun to see them as the face of immigration reform. It's rare to see someone like President Obama, as well as our own U.S. Senator Marco Rubio, talking about the same group of individuals in the immigration context, dreamers, and call them innocents, because they really are. And they should be the face of the discussion for reform. And these efforts and these impediments are more form over substance. Certainly Jose's case typifies that. As a matter of fact, his lawyer is former president of the ABA, as well as the Florida
American
State
Bar
Association. Yes, exactly. And if someone like that is willing to represent this cause, and Sandy Dallenberg, I hope to reach out to him this week, because I want to begin an initiative, not unlike I did in California with the petition of legal experts and attorneys in the state, not necessarily with the intent of swaying the court, because it's not a political endeavor. But maybe it's time for our political environment, our leaders in the legislature, and even the governor, to reconsider their stance, particularly with an individual like Jose.
Eliberto Roman, thanks for joining us today on Issues.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Up next, are small businesses optimistic about 2014? Stay with us. Some people are concerned that there are mixed economic signals for small businesses as we enter this new year. Access to credit continues to be a critical issue. This and Obamacare, if you want to transition and grow and become a medium-sized business, is also a concern. Joining us to discuss this is Albert Williams, Associate Professor of Finance and Economics at Nova Southeastern University. Albert, good to see you. Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you, too. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thanks. So I know you're an optimist by nature, but there are people in the small business community who say, you know what? We're not in a different place than we were 2 years ago, particularly when you look at the access to credit and community banks, which continue to be burdened by what for them might be excess regulations. Yet there are others who are saying, you know what, 2014 is probably better than you realize. What do you think?
Well, I'll tell you, you're right in saying that I'm an optimist, because I do like to look at the world that is half full. And they've done some studies to look at small businesses. And in fact, 83% of them were saying, you know, I need to look at the world that it's the bucket is half full. So there's some optimism out there. But let me throw some numbers at you. Just this morning, the unemployment rate came out, and it fell even lower to 6.7% across the country. Now, when you're talking about small businesses, you have to look at the other side of the coin. They'll do well if the consumers have money to spend, because they go together. So if you look at Florida, our unemployment rate is only around 6.4%. I'm sure you saw how many people went shopping over the Christmas holidays. So there's some excitement there.
Yes, but at the same time, you see that Lowman's has filed for bankruptcy, which for me means that I'm in mourning. And then you have the Macy's announced on Thursday that they're letting go of 2,500 employees, and they weren't the seasonal workers that they normally hire. I don't know that the drop in unemployment is because people have stopped looking for work, which is a factor that sometimes drops the unemployment
right.
number. There are a lot of people who just don't feel, despite what some numbers might say, if you're not well invested in the stock market, it's very likely you're not doing well.
Well, that's possible. What is happening is that when you see a 7% or a 6.7%, you have to then dive deeper to kind of figure where it is. So like they said, we only created 74,000 jobs when that number came about. So, but they've done a little bit better with like, we have 4 million people in the United States that are.
I bet you those 74,000, how many of those came from the public sector? Because the month before, we had 40% that came from the public sector. And I realize you haven't had enough time to be able to go through this.
Well, I actually looked at the public sector too, and they're actually cutting back also. So this increase in jobs is not a lot compared to what we had expected, around 200,000. But it is an increase, and the numbers are dropping. We have to look at the long-term trend rather than just a little short-term. So the long-term trend is saying, you know, the numbers are going down, but I'm not. We have to be careful. It's not across the board everybody is doing well. And so, like, I looked at the numbers for small businesses, and what they're saying is that only the bigger of the small businesses are hiring. The little ones, like 75% of those small businesses, are not hiring.
Well, okay, that's such an important point. How do you define small business?
And I knew you were going to ask that, and I did a research in it because it is such a ticklish or difficult issue. I went to the small business association from the government, and their definition is it depends on which industry you're in. I'll give you one or two. If you're service, if you're less than 21 million in sales per year, that's considered small. If you're in wholesaling, if you have between 100 and 500 people, that's considered small. Manufacturing is crazy.
Wait a minute. In wholesale, if you're between 100 and 500, that's small?
Small, in that range. Wow. That is the challenge. In fact, I read a Forbes report that says, we don't believe in these categories because we don't understand what it means. So I think definition-wise, it's dangerous. It's difficult to identify what small is. But I think we look at the number of people employed. Like, I have a wonderful number that I wanted to share with you. Small businesses in Miami-Dade County, 66 million firms. 66,000 firms. 60,000 of those employ 20 people or less.
And that would be my definition of small, or 25 or less.
Right.
Like that.
And then over 500 people, only 1,500. That's 2%. So roughly 90% of these firms hire 20 people or less. While I was driving here today, you look at hundreds of little businesses. They don't hire that many people. But in terms of payroll, those numbers, 60,000 only accounts for 7 billion, which is 21%. The 1,500 big ones account for 51% of the payroll. So there is a huge number of small ones, but the big ones have a lot of clout. And so that's the challenge we have to see. So you have a, like, almost like a bipolar kind of structure that you have to see. Yeah, we have a lot of small ones, but they don't have a whole bunch of payroll.
So there isn't a lot of opportunity. What's the kind of opportunity these small ones have, given the climate that you see today, to be able to survive and perhaps even grow a little?
You know, the small ones will only grow if the consumers are coming around, and we are seeing signs that the consumers, in fact, I have a marvelous number here, that disposable income across the country has increased by 0.5%. So if you see that people are making more money, then these people that have their small businesses will start to increase. I just discussed that in class this past Wednesday, and we're saying that small businesses are smart people. If they see that the increase in demand, that will drive them to hire more people. And so some are seeing it, and that's my optimism. But you have to remember that it's not like everybody's enjoying the pie right now. It's coming slowly. So I will never come out and say, gee, we're out of there. We're just improving. The economy is definitely expanding. And it has its challenges. That's one of the things you were asking about. The Affordable Care Act or Obamacare, you know, I think a lot of this is misinformation, because if you have 20 people or less, you will never have to do this. Mm-hmm. But if you have 50 or more, so we need to educate our small businesses. And I would appeal to the chambers, even the universities, mine. We need to get out there and help our people, our businesses, to make that marriage so that they don't find this so scary. Scary is not good.
What about the access to credit, that continues to be a huge problem.
It is. I've spoken to several people, and I've looked at the numbers. Again, you remember I partitioned the small business, the big, the middle, and a lot of little ones. The big ones are finding credit, but the little ones are having difficulty to find credit because the banks have been burnt. So they're quite conservative, and so they're lending mostly to the folks that they understand. So we need, again, to figure ways as a society how to expand credit for the smaller businesses. That's a tough nut to crack.
That is, and the importance of access to credit for small businesses very often is that perhaps they're getting paid later or on a delayed schedule from their suppliers or contractors.
Definitely.
Which creates that problem. And the access to credit helps them meet payroll obligations every 2 weeks or weekly every
Absolutely
2 weeks.
Right.
And without that, they just can't survive.
You know, small businesses, people have to understand the characteristics of them. They go from week to week or so and so. They don't have that big cushion like some of the mega corporations. So they do need that working capital to bridge the gap. But we call it the grease to keep the business running.
But all in all, 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
It is going to be a good year as far as you can tell.
All the numbers from the World Forecasting Report from Christine Lagarde, the IMF chief, down the road, we're seeing good signs across the world. So I come here with good news for you.
Well, that is a wonderful way to start the new year. Albert, thanks so much for joining us today.
It's a pleasure.
Many thanks to Albert Williams for joining us and to you for joining us as well. I'm Helen Ferre. Thank you for watching.